A very warm I extend a very warm and hearty welcome to our distinguished resource person, Mr. Rohit Swaroop, Chairman, Innovation and Research Foundation, Madam Shilpi Ghosh from Innovation and Research Foundation, and our Honorable Principal, Dr. Navjot Kaur, and all the participants to this online session on design-driven innovation for faculty, which is being organized by Innovation Cell of our college in collaboration with Innovation and Research Foundation, Ahmedabad. Nowadays, innovation has become core and central fulcrum on which the future skill set is dwelt. It is no more an option, but has become more or less a mandate in colleges and universities. And the innovation cell of our college is not only meant to promote creativity and entrepreneurial skills of students, but it is also meant to encourage faculty members to be more creative and innovative. As faculty members are the think tanks who are continuously thinking about improvement through change. Hence, we the faculty can become platforms for supporting innovation. And this is where the role of design thinking becomes pivotal. And with this purpose, today's expert session is exclusively for the faculty members. And before we start with today's session, I would request our worthy principal, ma'am, Dr. Navjot Kaur, to welcome our esteemed resource person and address the participants. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Dr. Ramandeep. A very warm good morning to all the privileged participants to begin with. And after that, on behalf of the management of this college, the Sikh Educational Society, the faculty members and students, I extend a heartfelt welcome to the resource person of the day, Mr. Rohit Swaroop, Chairman, Innovation and Research Foundation, Founder, Explorer Education Private Limited, and Founder, Future Explore. Mr. Rohit Swaroop will be focusing on design-driven innovation for faculty, and this event is being organized by the Innovation Cell of Sri Guru Gobind Singh College, in collaboration with the Innovation and Research Foundation, Ahmedabad. We all welcome you, sir, for sparing your time, and we are looking forward to a very innovative and a productive session with you. But before that, I would like to share a few things about my college. It is my pride to share with you that Sri Guru Gobind Singh College, Chandigarh, has a very strong legacy of more than 55 years, which rests on the ideology of the 10th Guru of Sikhs, Sri Guru Gobind Singh. And we are a well-established leading institute of academic repute in this region, and we are striving to make a global presence at the same time. And the vision and mission of our college is to promote a holistic development of our students with a healthy amalgam of the modern and the tradition at the same time. It is always an endeavor to keep these students and faculty abreast of the modern technologies, the innovations and research. I also wish to draw your attention to the new education policy, which is going to be here soon, that will introduce something called the academic credit banks across the higher education institutions, where a student can digitally store major and minor credits. Now, there will be these will be considered at the time of awarding degrees and diplomas. In order to explore specialties for this and earn credits in the bargain, I think the role of the innovation cell gains immense importance. Henceforth, once the new education policy comes in. So here, the The innovation cell of our college has been set up as per the guidelines of the innovation cell, Ministry of Human Resource Development, Government of India, with an objective to foster a culture of innovative thinking amongst the entire faculty and student, and to give a boost to the Make in India program of the Government of India. At the same time, implement the National Innovation and Startup Policy. The cell strives to provide creative energy of our students by organizing several webinars, panel discussions, expert sessions, competitions, training programs, and workshops, so that they work on new ideas and develop their entrepreneurial and innovative abilities. Today, an expert session is an endeavor in this similar direction. Dr. Taranjeet Rao, along with her team members, is putting in immense efforts to initiate the faculty and students into the innovative thought processes. So, Mr. Rohit Swaroop, we are looking forward to your inputs towards the innovation cell. And with such a brilliant CV that I have read out, I'm sure we are going to gain a lot from it. Looking forward to the session. I'm handing over to Ramandeep ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you for your kind and inspirational words. I would like to introduce the eminent speaker of the day, Mr. Rohit Swaroop, Chairman, Innovation and Research Foundation. He is working with various state governments in India, China, and Canada on projects related to education ecosystem creation in management, technology, and design. He is also a regular guest at Doordarshan TV programs on digital media, design, and innovation. Mr. Swaroop is a jury member and actively involved in academic and consulting assignments with prominent institutions of national repute. He is also on the jury board of Atal Community Innovation Center, a Niti Aayog initiative by the Government of India. He has more than 25 years of experience in delivering more than 500 seminars and workshops at several national and international forums. He is the founder chairman of Innovation and Research Foundation. In addition, he is the founder director of Explora Design School, India's premier digital media design education company, having numerous campuses in India and China, and founder director Futures Explored, implementing design subject culture zones and lab in 2000 plus schools in several countries. Mr. Swaroop is also the recipient of two national awards, Shiksha Bharati Puraskar for training and providing employment to 100,000 students and professionals, and the Indian Leadership Award for Educational Excellence for the Innovative Curriculum of the 21st Century. We welcome you, sir. Now, before we start with the session, I request Ms. Shilpi Ghosh to acquaint the participants with Innovation and Research Foundation. Over to you, Madam Shilpi.
So, Shilpi, just a small request. Since we have already had an elaborate introduction about the organization.
Yes, sir.
I would request that we skip that formality and save the time to get into this.
Yes, sir. Over to you, sir. You can take position.
Very, very good morning to all friends. First of all, the name of your institution itself evokes a different kind of spiritual awakening right in the morning. When I saw the name of the institution itself, that says everything that one wants to know. We strongly follow the followings of Guru Gobind Singh Ji as well as Guru Nanak Sahib. So in that context, I would appreciate everyone involved in this noble cause of spreading education. The institution itself is very prominently known among different academic fraternity. So I'd like to thank Navjot Kaur Ji, Taranjit Ji, and Ramandeep Ji for organizing this event. Friends, it's been about 20 years that I'm involved with certain organizations, specifically in context of innovation. So when friends from good institutions neighboring in Ahmedabad, we are fortunate that we have some of the top institutions of the country in our city. So when we interact with institutions like NID, that is National Institute of Design, where I'm a jury member and a faculty for strategic design management, or it is IIM Ahmedabad, where I contribute to brand management and emerging technologies. So as part of that, all of us used to feel that this synergistic growth of institutions and departments lays a strong foundation for the future. And when we talk about this synergistic growth, I see that your institution already has a strong pillar of humanities on one side and science, commerce and application of those. And in that context, a holistic approach is a natural extension to innovation. So as an institution, sometimes we feel hampered when we talk to IITs or NITs, which are driven with one kind of discipline, which is engineering. It really is challenging to change their mindset and to orient them towards the interesting field of humanities, anthropology, ethnography, as well as behavioral sciences, and which are very essential in today's time if we were to have innovation as one of the spirit of our country. So with that, I would like to start this session. Today, we are going to have the session will be in two parts. First, I would like to share some of the case studies that have been conducted, which are examples which we can actually adapt for our organization, for our departments, or as faculty members. That's the first part. The second part is we will have question answers and specific discussion if there is some inputs, because I'm part of the AIM Atal Innovation Mission team. So if there are certain questions in also the context of new education policy, then please feel free to let me know those. We can address that. Roughly, it will be around 25 minutes, 30 minutes of the case study and then question answer. And please excuse me if I go a little fast in the session today because of lack of time and the vast ocean of information on innovation. We would progress a little fast. So please hold your questions. The moment I finish a specific case, you can feel free to ask. So with that, let me share the screen and begin the session for today. I hope we are able to see the screen and we can take the initiative from here. Now, while I was thinking about which organization can I share information about? So in that context, I thought that let me share and begin by sharing what have institutions at the DNA level. So at the core of an institution, how innovation can be instilled so that it is not a piecemeal thing. Many organizations in the world, they started with saying that we would have a specific cell or a department or an incubator or a pre-incubator or accelerator. But later on, as innovation ecosystem evolves, it mandates that we are able to bring in innovation in the DNA of the institution. So I would start with that example and then we'll share some for some more. These are some of the places where we have worked extensively for development of innovation ecosystem at an institutional level. So I would cite now the example of one of the interesting projects that we did. This project came from the government of UP, and it was a very straightforward project in the sense that they said we are looking forward to establishing a National Institute of Design, NID, in UP. So we had to persuade them that NID itself is reinventing in context of almost half a century of existence. So why set up another NID? Let's look at a contextual to the state institution. Now, while I give this example, friends, we can connect this example to as faculty members to what we are doing at in our own departments at institution. So please feel free to ask me some questions post this case about specifics if you may want to know a little. So we said that we will use design as an approach in order to create this kind of an institution. And we were fortunate at that time that we got a go ahead that yes, we are okay if you can recontextualize the institution rather than saying that it is another NID being established. So what we did over a period of 6 months, we met all the stakeholders that we felt. So it was an extensive exercise. When we met the government and ministerial level people, their objective was that we want a national level institution in the domain of design in our state so that it can provide livelihood and well-being for the citizens. When we talked to secretary level people, they had an interesting input and they said, UP has 40 craft clusters. Can we do something about these craft clusters in order to revitalize or engage them meaningfully for the state, which was a very different thing than if we talk about design. It's a very different approach when we say that, okay, can we look at the craft clusters of the state? When we talk to the artisans and craftsmen in these craft clusters, they said we have been practicing our art for years and centuries. However, the next generation is not very excited to get into what we are doing. The second thing that came from them is that we are not able to contextualize ourselves to the changed world requirements and trends. So can we do something about that? When we met the citizens, as in to understand what do they perceive of an institution of this kind, it was very interesting. They said that we are not familiar that we have 40 different craft clusters. So can there be a method in which the population as such can be brought into and made a stakeholder in this whole process? Then we will be familiar that it is such a rich craft legacy that we have for the state. When we talk to the young students, two things emerged. One, of course, a lot of them felt that they wanted to have, of course, an employment at the end of the program or self-employment. But the other factor that came out was that they were wanted to learn at a place which can be engaging and which can be not more of a concept or theory, but also application of the same, studying with some of the best academicians. So with these different objectives, we set out a plan of how should we go about. So here, friends, I would like to take a minute and familiarize each one of us with what actually design approach is. It may be called design thinking in the context of current time, but since up to number of years we have used design as a pedagogy. In fact, India as a country is rich in using a multidisciplinary, bring holistic approach to any domain. If we talk about even a small example, when some of you must have visited the National Institute of Design, or when you visit in future, you will see that right at the most prominent place of our institution, we have put a pot, which is called a lota. And the reason for that is that after extensive study of our nation, Charles Ames, who came to establish NID, said that India's legacy of design is much deeper than the world, which is exhibited in small device, small thing that we use like a lota, because there are more than 500 variety of lota, the pot that we carry water in the country, based on the context and based on the region and based on the requirement, there are 500 plus varieties. So in the context, let me establish in the contemporary time when we talk about design thinking, it is, some of you must be familiar, but for the benefit of others too, there are three easy ways to explain it. One is, it is called a double diamond. So the shape of a diamond, two diamonds put side by side. That's why a double diamond. What this means is when we see this diamond shape, there is diverging and then again converging, again diverging and converging. The first diamond can be taken as a problem finding diamond, and the second one can be the problem solving. The problem finding diamond, when we talk of diverging, we talk of when we, like this study that we did, let us talk to as many stakeholders to get their perspective on a specific topic or a domain. Like in this case, it was establishing institution. So when we diverge, we say, let's meet as many stakeholders and identify range of their perspective. It is, it may also be called that we are collecting data for any topic or a subject. Like in context of the current time, if we look at the pandemic, the whole rich data that has come to us from across the world has helped us in knowing the situation in totality. Now the converging part of the first diamond is where we say that we have so much data, how do we converge and arrive at some of the problem statements that can address the situation? In this whole stage, we never talk about any solution. We talk only about the problem stage. So if I was to cite this current example of institutional development, it took us 6 months just in the problem finding space in order to get views, opinions, perspectives of different stakeholders onto what kind of an institution should we establish. Now comes the second diamond. We say, again, we say diverge, which says get as many ideas as possible. So creativity, idea generation, and coming up with as many ideas, and then again converging to a solution, which we say in design is prototyped, means creating a beta or a tangible outcome of the ideas that we have, and then to be tested. So generally, design thinking is described as this double diamond approach. Different places in different parts of the world use it in a different manner. For example, some of the places like Harvard or Stanford or MIT uses it as understanding the environment, observing the environment, studying the system, going to the root cause by compassion and empathy towards people, then articulating the problem. Idea generation, prototyping, and testing. So I thought of sharing this because for some of us who may be listening to design approach as the first time, there are many misconceptions and views. Some of us who work with software may know that this approach is very prominent in the software domain, where we use design approach, agile, lean, under a project management approach of Scrum. So with that, now let me go ahead. Once we did this iteration, we thought that let us come up with an institution which could be addressing the requirements that have been posted. So here, friends, if you notice, is what emerged. We said there will be three areas: dissemination, innovation, and promotion. Now, if we see here are the educational programs. But what we said is, if we look at this design studio, it could be considered as a classroom. It can be in our context. It can be considered as a lab. It can be considered as any place where we would want to do the learning. Here we call it design studio. So what we said is each faculty member will, whenever the course is going on, any subject, will bring a specific subject that he or she wishes to teach in the studio. The faculty will invite from the 40 craft clusters an artisan or a craftsman to be on the campus from 3 to 6 weeks, depending on the length of the subject that they want to teach. And the students will be a part of it. So if we look at in this model, what we are saying is faculty the craftsman and the student. This can also be extrapolated as faculty member bringing a subject, industry intervention, and the student. It can also be faculty member, community topic, specific community related to what we are trying to teach, or a discipline that we were trying to teach. It could be a social cause, so bringing in somebody from there and the students. So what happens, friends, is when this iteration happens between academic real life and the student, the learning outcome of the students go to a very different level. So what we said is, once we will have this kind of a classroom, which will have industry interface or community interface on a regular basis as part of each subject. Now, once we have done this learning, so the objective of this is better learning of students. But since the craftsman is present in the class and the faculty members, two other things emerge. One is that the artisan can say that I have this problem or a challenge which I want to also get addressed. Like, for example, I want to create a wood toys but sell it to different part of the world, but I don't know what are the trends there. Now, the students and the faculty can help them in addressing it. That is why we say that in the classroom attached is a design clinic. It can be called as an industry clinic, where we are trying to solve the problems that they are bringing in. For the faculty members, it is even enriching that because they are not just teaching a subject, but they are seeing how an artisan or a craftsman is contextualizing it and students are learning, it produces original case studies for different craft sectors or different domains. It produces not just the case studies, but white papers, research publications. Commercializing the research that the institution is doing can happen, and outreach programs will result from the same. Now, once we look at this, we said, now we should connect it to the citizens, because the citizens had a complaint that we are not very familiar with the what kind of rich legacy we have. So we said we will should have a heart on the campus, where whatever is being produced in the classroom is being displayed and sold at the heart, where citizens can come and contribute. Some of the interesting work which we feel could be a path-breaking kind of, or a new direction, goes into the exhibition gallery. And finally, some of the intellectual property that gets created, very unique and original work, can go to the museum. Now, if we see, friends, this approach is iterated over, if it's a two-year program, it is iterated over 2 years, multiple times for different subjects here. Some of the subjects happen in the classroom on campus. Some of the subjects, the student and the faculty go to that craft cluster. But the objective remains same. We want to train the students onto a specific subject in context of real life and the challenges, and orient them to the tradition of the way that practice is being done. Now, if once this happens several times, I'm sure many of us will now appreciate that the outcome here is we have brought in real life industry or community. The children's learning is contextualized and solving a problem for that sector. The faculties have their own academic outcomes coming from the same. But since we are also linking it with commercialization, therefore the students understand the business side of it. So the core human need, the technology or the method or technique, and then the business aspect is iterated several times. And therefore, the byproduct, I would say, is that the students who come out from the placement, it becomes not the core thing, but it is the byproduct, which by going through this iteration, we have those skills that we talk about, the 21st century skills, like decision-making, problem solving, original thinking, connecting, communicating, and collaborating with people, working in teams to find solutions. All those become a process which is a byproduct of this whole approach of a project-based learning, or learning by doing, in the academic class. So I wanted to share this because many institutions across the world are now trying to completely reinvent the way they are doing things. For example, Harvard and MIT, that is Massachusetts Institute of Technology, have already started to convert their entire subject learning using the pedagogy of design approach. And in simple terms, what is a pedagogy of design approach is that double diamond that we start with a problem in mind, be it for any specific subject. And we bring that, like it could be pollution. We start with that topic and then try to work with the students to get a solution. And as a process, the whole subject gets taught. So this is the first example I wanted to share. I would be happy if there are any questions at this moment related to this model, or I will then go to the next case study to contextualize in that manner. If there are any questions, views, opinion, friends, please feel free. Otherwise, we move to the next case study. I see that we also have somebody from the data center. So in the same context for data center, I would like to share that many of the institutions now approach us when they teach a subject like data science or artificial intelligence, saying that can we have a real life problem in the classroom with data, which is real data, and the students can work on the same in order to solve a problem like I shared right now. So this is one method that I wanted to address here through that example. So what, since we don't have a question, let me go to the next case and then possibly post that we can have. The next case I would like to cite is about an institution called Gujarat Technological University, where they said that we want to revitalize the engineering temperament. Now, same is applied to different disciplines where we contribute. Here it is an example for engineering, but we use the same example, revitalizing the management temperament, or revitalizing the architecture temperament, or revitalizing the pure sciences temperament, or revitalizing the liberal arts temperament. So how do we do that? Here I'm giving an example of engineering, but you may contextualize it in your own discipline. So when we started this project, we said there'll be three broad stages. The first stage will look at revitalizing engineering temperament. And therefore, we should have certain specific subject. Like previously, we said how an institutional development happens so that the byproduct is the innovation or startups or in innovation in academics. Here we said, let us introduce specific subjects. So we call the subjects as design engineering. Now, under GTU, there are about 120 plus engineering colleges of Gujarat. It's a nodal body. And so we introduce four subjects, design engineering, semester 3, 4, 5, and 6. The approach remains same, the double diamond, but in semester 3, we say the students will bring the problems from their surrounding, which is villages, small towns, and using this approach in a team, students will address it. In semester 4, we said that the students will bring a problem related to the discipline that they have selected. So if it is the specific kind of engineering discipline, they would work with that. Same is in pharmaceutical. They'll choose in pharmacy, they'll choose a domain that they have identified. Semester 5, they will connect and identify an organization of their interest in which they are specializing and then solve a problem there. And semester 6, they will try to see that the project that they will do in the final year, they need to identify and take up a topic and work on that. Now, friends, what happened by doing this approach is that we started to evaluate the students on the process and not the outcome. And therefore, some of you must be familiar, especially in engineering sector, in the final year UDP-IDP projects, the students either copy a project or they buy the learning from outside. And this was the challenge that the Honorable Vice Chancellor Saab that time, Agarwal Ji, mentioned to us 8 years back, that we want to remove that and have students having a mindset and a temperament for innovation in engineering, and therefore the outcome should be that their project should be original. And therefore, by the help of these four subjects, repeated iteration of design cycle in each semester, finally we said that the evaluation will be on the process and not the final outcome. The second thing that we tried to do, which is working quite well, is because this whole projects were embedded in real life and students had to find a problem from real life and local industry, the industry student connect became very strong. So some of the infrastructure that is not present in institutions, they found that the local industry has that infrastructure and those capabilities. So when we connect our students there, they are able to utilize their research facility or the lab or the know-how that the industry can share. At the same time, the industry confidence started to build when the faculties and the students work with them to solve the problem. Now, in the current context, a lot of MSMEs are facing this challenge, and therefore, it is sometimes meaningful to engage with them and address their challenges. It could be the social cause or it could be a business cause taken up here. In the third stage, we said we will connect it to the startup movement of the country and the state, and also to see that these original ideas that students are coming up can be taken to the patent level. So for doing this, we created the entire, and this is open source. Any of you can actually write to me. I'll give you the link where you can actually see how this whole programs are structured. And we said we would help create. So over this period, we created an open design school for them because we strongly believe there is no infrastructural requirement in current time. There is so much of infrastructure available in our country that if we collaborate with the right organizations, it is only the intellectual property that or knowledge that we center that we wanted to create. So it's an open design school that supports all the 120 plus engineering colleges. Now we have four zonal open design schools there. And therefore a lot of things had to be done because each year we get roughly about 55,000 students in GTU. And so over a period of 4 years, and if we can understand as engineers move ahead, there is that rich kind of data that gets created in terms of projects. So there are a range of faculty development programs, online sessions, which are open source. I have a full 7-session program on engineering, which is on the GTU YouTube channel, open source for anyone to take up the program. So those kind of program resulted. So these are two institutional support mechanism. Now I would like to cite contextual to the first two cases were innovation as an ecosystem at an institutional level. Now why we do the same for JNTU, for engineering and management, but we were approached by them saying that every year we do a competition across the state of Telangana and we bring in the most promising students who have ideas for startup. So for them, we created a 26-session program where all these roughly 80 participants almost every year, they get to, and we get to work with them in order to create a startup. And happy to share that over this year on year, we are getting, right now also that program is on, like last, I think just a few days back, we had a session on prototyping with all these students. And the key here, friends, is that many a times, and this is important from startup or innovation policy, that there are good ideas that students have, and there are good domains that they select. But it has been repeatedly found when we work with the incubators that the success ratio of the startup has remained quite low. And when we are putting so much resources behind a domain, it becomes essential that how do we are we able to raise the level and the approach approach to a manner that the outcomes become much better. So be it the kind of startups that get funded, be it the kind of ideas that students bring, can it be taken to the patent level? All these become an interesting opportunity that we can actually leverage. So we have therefore created a very unique, I'll share that before I go to the next case. I'll share this some of us who are more keen about innovation and startup at our campus. We created this program which was gifted to Niti Aayog AIM. This can now is being used as an approach. So a structured approach to startup creation. Many of us who would have dealt with students in this domain must have felt that many times as mentors, when we tell and guide them that I think that you should look at further this problem because sometime it is that the problem is not that grave. If it is grave, then is it really impacting larger masses? Will people pay for this kind of problems to be solved? Those kind of things, when we share with them, because they are in love with their idea, it's very difficult to persuade them to change the course. So what we thought is, if these are the five challenges that we have in startup domain, let us create a method where we will say that we will give the participants a challenge. We will give them tool, techniques, and method, and we will tell them to themselves go to the field and find answers whether they are in alignment to the startup success or not. So if we look at the first stage, the founder and the founding team, are they a good startup founding team, or are the founders well gelled in to what is expected in a startup or in a business community? So we give them framework, tools, and techniques. They go to the field, talk to a lot of people, and themselves try to address that whether they will succeed. If so, what are the things they'll need from an behavioral perspective, from a human perspective as a startup? The second, we say create hypothesis and assumptions based on the need that you have identified. So like I gave the example, then they have to go to the field and test out whether the problem they have identified is really genuine and whether people will pay for it, whether it is scalable and that and so forth. This whole program runs in an interesting modular fashion of 3 days, 3 weeks, 3 months, and even 9 months. Like, for example, in places where we run an entrepreneurial program of a year, it runs as a 9-month program of startup creation and entrepreneurship. And the students go through these modules. So need, then the solution, which is idea generation, where they are exposed to lateral thinking, which is radical ideas, incremental thinking, which are divergent thinking, which is incremental ideas, and techniques like Scamper, Triz, and others for structured approach to idea generation. Post that, we expose them to now create hypothesis and test out the value proposition of your business. Now, when I am explaining these friends, the same actually applies at a faculty level for any innovation that we want to produce. For example, let us take up recently, we did a faculty development intensive program with one of the institutions where there were around 21 participants. So we said in groups of three, each of you choose a domain that you find challenging. So some of them chose commercializing the research they do. Some of they said making online education more engaging, or one of the groups took blended learning for future. One of the groups took connecting alumni, industry, and students. One of the groups took integrating the curricular, co-curricular, and extracurricular activity in terms of holistic outcome based approach to these club activities. One of them took a project saying that we want to connect with the industry MSME and create a funnel for our students for live projects. So this team, these different groups took different projects. We use the same approach that I'm sharing here. Problem finding, going to the root cause, understanding the human need, what are the different perspective of different stakeholder, including students, their parents, alumni, industry, everyone's perspective in the same, and then going to the problem solving stage. And then, of course, contextualizing and prototyping. We said each team will have to create a 3 months of roadmap and then apply the same and see whether it's working or not. So the same approach, actually. And then sometime, friends, when we talk of business model, it is not just business. It could be an impact model of education. Like right now, there is a big talk on outcome-based education and how can we use. So we are going to do a program with one of the prominent institutions in November, where our primary focus is connecting how do we use this whole approach to lead to outcome, a better outcome and expectations, connecting the institution objective, the university objective, and the larger framework objective, at the same time keeping the students' industry in preview. So the same approach goes through for creating a startup there. Now I would like to share just a couple of more case studies, little diverse from, because we have talked about different disciplines. Now here I would like to share about the efforts in terms of, like, suppose we are looking at innovation at our institution, then as part of AIM, there are several, if we see on the right-hand side, there are several models that work. Like, for example, innovation at a grassroots level, so soil level innovation. So at that time, we talk about students coming up with ideas and coming up with unique ideas and finding unique problems. We are not too worried about taking it to the incubation stage. It's a pre-incubation. The second stage, we can also be an incubator. The third stage, we can be accelerator, where people bring their startups and we help them grow to the next level. It can also be an interesting community center where we connect the community, industry, the society for innovation. So there are several models of innovation. I would like to only cite few things here which are important, and I'm sure our institution must have looked at it. Whenever we look at innovation, it is always good to first look inward. What are the resources, capabilities that our institution has? Be it the faculty strength, be it the industry strength, be it the kind of community strength that we have. So here, as I'm sharing this example, we said that we will look at a region. This is one of the regions in Gujarat, and say we'll identify both MSME and big industries and make our incubator contextual to addressing the problem of these sector. Same way, the other campus that we have at Mumbai, we said we will look at Mumbai as a creative content hub of the country. But we said that there are 54% Mumbai lives in slum locality. How can we provide a startup opportunity to this specific segment? So what I'm trying to address, friends, here is that if we go highly contextual to the region, to a community or sector, or to a industry that is prevailing, then it becomes very meaningful as an startup activity or innovation domain. Now, it could be for startup, it could be for academic entrepreneurship. When I say academic entrepreneurship, what I mean is all of us faculties, as part of the, of course, higher education policy, now faculty members, it is moving in a direction will be recognized where we can have some stake in a student startup also. So encouraging entrepreneurship activities within the academic fraternity. It could be related to startup, it could be related to creating patents, it could be relating to white papers or research publications that we already do. But can we look at the same in context of who we are and who we want to serve as a interesting challenge. Like, for example, in one of the institutions in Hyderabad, they have many institutions. They also have a medical college. They also have art facility. They have a science college, a commerce. So we said, can we connect all of this together and see, even by talking to students and stakeholders? So finally, we said we would create three things. One, entrepreneurial activities for girls, that is women sector, focused on women entrepreneurship as a social cause. And at the same time, we said, because we are in healthcare, we look at healthcare sector for the startup. So this is what I would like to share and take from here. I would like to skip now these and come to an interesting case, which is from now, these are, of course, some of the initiatives where we contribute actively. Like for the Tata Group, the Titan, they wanted to promote social entrepreneurship. So we have created a 8-module program for them, which is completely online, which the aim is to reach 100,000 young people from engineering, design, and architecture for social innovation. Same way, we support the other vertical of Tata called the upcoming Next Learn, where there are 6 programs that are created for innovation to support MSME. Again, the entire initiative is online. Why I'm sharing these, friends, that as institution, we may have many such resources, which if connected with in the industry or the right sector, can lead to so much of programs and outcomes from institutional perspective, like these kind of program. Of course, another one is with Tata Ion, which is the creative thinking module, which is as less as we had said as a philanthropic, just 299 rupees for a full year for students. So why I'm sharing is this is the way innovation is taking place in the academic fraternity for the benefit of the country. Now, I'd like to share here that as part of this, we have association with organizations such as US3DIT, which is the original organization that started additive manufacturing in the world. Similarly, with IIT Kanpur for additive manufacturing and IIT Madras for artificial intelligence and augmented and virtual reality. Now, I would like to just give one case and then stop with it. This is a case very different from academic perspective. I think you will appreciate what one of the very senior faculty members, Subhash Bhatnagar Saab at IIM, he said that I am teaching a specific course in the second year called e-governance. And we met actually chance meeting at MITI Digital India, where I was talking on a design approach for e-governance problems for the CIOs and collectors. So they would bring a problem over 2 days. We will work with them to solve that problem. It could be a problem related to attendance in the rural schools. It could be health-related challenges. It could be engaging the women of certain community in local cooperative business activities. It could be any problem that comes from different parts of the country through these collectors and CIOs. So there we met, and he saw this approach of design, and he said, can I make my subject learning of e-governance better? So we can contextualize this to any subject that you are teaching. Can the subject learning be enhanced by using this approach as a project? Previously, we saw that how by giving certain subjects, we are able to run through students in a manner that they learn that subject by a realistic approach. Here we said, in e-governance, we said it's a 2-credit course, so let us divide. He took 1 credit for the academic side of it, conceptual input and those. And he said, these are the 10 objectives that I want to be achieved in better learning of my students. Now, 1 credit is for a project that the students will do, live project, contextual to e-governance. So we chose 8 PSUs. The class is a small because it's a second year elective, so 24 students. So we chose in groups of 3, we chose 8 institutions that they can work with. And they went through this whole approach of problem finding and problem solving in a structured manner. They had to identify, so I'll give an example. One of the groups chose waste management. So how the waste is generated, how the waste is stored, transported, segregated, or recycled. They had to look at the entire waste management system and propose some solutions that can be directly taken up by that organization. So interestingly, after a few days of field work, they came back and said that the technology side is fine, but can we work on bringing dignity to the workforce, this waste management workforce? So we were quite surprised how they found that. So they said that since these waste management workforce is not treated well by the citizens or by different stakeholders, their performance and efficiency is very low because they've almost resigned to that this is my job and I have to just do this. So can we bring dignity to them? The kind of clothes they wear, the kind of routine that they have, the kind of environment they are exposed to, can we bring those kind of changes even in the way we address them? Can we work on that? So we were very happy that now looking at the human side of, they were looking at the human side of the problem, and they said technology can be an interface for it, like creating an app to reward and recognize the people who brought dignity to the workforce could be an outcome. So at the end of this 1 credit course, they did a live project with an organization. They found a problem and solved it, but we kept in preview the 10 objectives that we had set out, which had to be brought out from e-governance. Now, same can be applied in any subject learning. Like if we want any 3 objectives, which are the key objectives or the learning, then connecting the same to a real life project. Of course, this model has now gone to a different level where different IIMs have also taken it up for teaching different subjects using design pedagogy, like IIM Lucknow and then several other. So here I would now stop, friends, because the idea was to share a bouquet of activities in innovation in academic and support. This whole initiative for IIM Lucknow is very interesting, that after the students did a project with organizations, the organizations came back and said that can we work with you to find solution to our problem? So what we did is we said, let's do a 2.5-day clinic, which is like a management development program or executive program. And like I explained about the faculty development, same way we said we'll do this. And the same companies where students had gone to choose a problem and give solution, they came back for almost 2.5 days. So all prominent organizations from the country, different sectors, but with the topic of sales leadership. Because here the objective was sales leadership. The course that we taught was marketing management for it was connected with industry. So on top of that, we created a program, and now it's become a very popular program on institution. So faculty members can therefore engage in this multiple ways with industry and have the outcomes. So I would like to stop here, friends, and because otherwise it will be too much of an information in too short a time. But the idea today was that whatever are different domains, and while I'm sharing these case studies, these are similar case studies happening across the world. These are some that I thought that where we are contributing, let me share the original ones. But if we look at MIT, they're converting their entire subjects in the way it is being taught based on project-based learning outcomes or using design pedagogy for doing the same. It's an open source. If any one of you may be interested, I can later on share the link and you can look up to those unique ways in which organizations are developing academic entrepreneurship. So we'll stop here and looking forward to questions, views, opinions, anything specific to our institution, if there is something that you may have and wish to ask or discuss. It will be our pleasure.
Thank you so much, sir. Yes, two of the members of Innovation Cell, they want to ask some questions.
Please.
Sir, please explain Breezer's prototyping.
Sorry, please, can you come again?
Sir, he's not audible. Sir, please explain business prototyping.
Business prototyping. Okay. So there are prototyping.
She's asking to explain business prototyping.
Yes, I got that. So there are prototyping. When we look at it, we look at three levels of prototype. The first level of prototype is idea to paper, which includes things like graphic organizers, storyboards, paper models, all of those. Then the second level, we talk about paper to a model or a concept. So if it is things like creating basic wireframe to creating mockups. In this stage, if the product is like, let us say, a tangible product, then they go towards the model side. If it is intangible, then they go to the concept side. It could be flowcharts, diagrams, and those. At the third level, we say from idea to paper, paper to a model or a concept, and then from model to or a concept to business. Now, the moment we say business, there are many models that are available. Like one of the easiest model that one can adapt is a business model canvas. So now if we see what we are talking about is from the startup, taking them to a stage of prototype where they are testing idea. Now we are saying, let us test our business. And now that is divided into three phases: pilot stage, launch stage, and growth stage. So when they look at a business model canvas, they look at all these three stages that their startups will be going through in context of several scenarios. Like when the scenario changes from region to region, will the model have an impact? As part of that, they create a business plan and also at the end of it, a launch plan, which is a Gantt chart of activities mapped against the business outcomes they want to approach. Like, for example, where should they have, what kind of partnerships can they have? What innovation can they bring in partnership? What kind of revenue streams are they proposing? Based on the revenue streams, can we change the business model and increase or change the revenue streams? Can we look at different customer relationship models coming out from it? Can we look at a costing based on a completely different parameter in the sense of encouraging exchange as a concept or barter as a concept in the cost management? So what we do is that the students are encouraged to look at these several of the nine parameters of either a business model canvas, or they also are encouraged to look at a topic specific. For example, how can a startup bring innovation in the marketing activities they do? Or can they look at a financial model in a different way? Can they look at their organization design in a very different way? Like, we are familiar that some of the organizations, like classic examples of LinkedIn or Pinterest, I would say Instagram, they reach their billion with only 13 employees, 1-3. How could they do that? The model that they used for their HR practices, how can they be looked at? Or how can the organization design be looked at to bring innovation? All these are parts of the business prototype that they create. So we divide prototypes ideally in three stages. The first is testing the idea. Second is testing the solution. And then third is testing the business. So this, I'm happy that you've asked this question, because this last component is the most ignored. And that is why sometimes the challenges of business not being such, idea may be great, but as a business, will it work or not is a different concept. So happy you asked that. If you feel sometime, like I just did a very interesting program for one of the prominent universities in the country on prototype, just on prototyping and series of prototyping. So the aim was that can we orient, one more point here, prototyping, and since Anupama ji has asked that question, prototype is also an approach. So as academicians, can we use an approach of prototype? What it means, whatever we are creating as a solution, can it be tested out in a tangible outcome? This whole approach of prototype is being used by the Western academic fraternity, that prototyping as an approach to problem solving. We are right now saying that prototype is that a startup has a prototype, but how can we make our students oriented towards prototype? Like we say that we want to develop a temperament for original thinking, we can also say we want to develop a temperament for doing, which is creating prototypes. Because the kind of learning that they have happens when they start to visualize a specific model brings a lot of development in the critical thinking domain. So happy that you asked that question, so I could address it at two levels: prototyping as in concept for startup, and prototyping as a concept for academic faculty members.
Okay. Thank you, sir.
Pleasure.
So there is another question. So I want to know how we can generate, as an innovation cell member, how we can generate the funds for, so that we can do more activities, or we can give the benefits to the students.
Yes. So actually, I would cite, if you saw a few of the slides that I showed about the activities in Mumbai and in specific region called Saurashtra, the key, Meena ji, would be that the incubator is, or our startup cell, is it sector specific, domain specific? Like, for example, some of them look at, I want to address this specific sector. So there's a lot of sectoral specific funds that are available. Like, for example, MHRD has a specific range of funds available for if we are able to address specific sector problem. One is that. So first I would suggest is, can we identify the specific sectors that we are good at and we want to focus on? The second can be, there are funds that are available specific for domains. Like, for example, somebody wants to look at health tech, edu tech, fintech. There are specific funds, like Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation focuses on immensely on edutech and health tech funding in our country. Same way, there are funds that are available for supporting MSME units. There are funds that are available through the Department of Science and Technology at a state level, where that fund is given specific to a certain kind of research and work done in specific sciences sector. Then there is a fund that is available through the NITI, which is related to, as I mentioned, it could be a community center, it could be, now there are many programs. It was Atal Incubators, then it is community center, then there are other programs that are also coming up. The key in all these activities, Meena ji, would be, how are we able to connect the innovation activities that we are doing in our campus, all of them connected together through a report or a file that gets created, and the same is then created in a manner that it helps to generate grants or funds. So if we are able to do that, then I'm confident, and please, you can later on write to us also in whatever way we can support. We will definitely try to support there. But the funding is thus the outcome of the entire activity. The string of activities that we do, the objectives that we set out, the communities we engage. Like, I'll give you an example, how we normally, if somebody, like we are supporting few institutions where they got certain funding, or a certain project. How we went about is, we documented everything the institution had done in the past in terms of innovation, the support of alumni in this regard, current student support, community support, all of that. Then we said, now let us in this 1 year where we want to structure ourselves to get the grant, let us do these few activities. So 3 faculty development programs related to innovation in academic, 2 programs specifically focused on startups for the students as well as for the community. So bringing people from community, and at the end, showing that these structured startups, like in both of these, we took roughly 20 student startup ideas, so about 40 students, and we said we have to have at least 15 of them to get the funding. Now, the funding could come through the SSIP scheme of the state and government and the central government, student support fund, which comes about 2 lakhs for the prototyping and creating their model, or it could be the community fund. The next, we said, let us do 2 community projects to showcase with the community, 2 projects with MSME to say that we are solving their problem with the help of students and faculty, and a few other. Now, if we see the string of activities, they lead to, like, I'm sure many institutions these days do hackathon or ideathon and those kind of, and some entrepreneurial activities. But are they resulting into startup creation? Are they resulting in startup getting funding? That is my real proposition, that if we structure ourselves that our startups get the funding, then our cell getting a funding will not be difficult at all. How are we able to showcase our things in the manner in which the expectation is there from the state Department of Science and Technology or these private funds or the government, central government fund? How are we able to create our files in this structured manner? So since I think others may not be too interested in this, we could have a separate meeting on this, and wherever we can understand the organization better and create this file which can be applied for funding. Funding is not a challenge, let me tell you. The challenge is the ecosystem where startups will succeed. So if we take 50 startups ideas in a year, will 20 of them get funding? If they do, then no question, or some of them get to patent. If that happens, funding to our cell will not be a challenge at all.
Thank you so much, sir.
Pleasure.
Ruchira, it seems you have a question. Please, you can go ahead with your question. Ruchira.
Hello, sir. Hello. Thank you for this enlightening session. I have a question that when we are in an institute where the students are not motivated by technological or applied background, and we teach basic subjects, my question is that how can we motivate them to spend the extra time and to do something extra other than their overloaded syllabus?
That's a very good question, because the last few lines that you spoke is actually the truth, the overloaded syllabus. Now, can you give me an example of any subject that you specifically teach?
Sir, for example, I teach biology. And
yeah, perfect. That's fine. That's fine. I understand the context. So what happens is when we start with the concept on biology or healthcare, health tech, what we begin with is there are a few interesting models. So we encourage the students to follow Charles Darwin's approach to the whole process of how he arrived at evolution. But what we tell the student is that we'll not give you the theory for evolution. You have to do a project where you will go through the tools that Charles Darwin used and come up with your original thoughts around biology topic. It could be biology itself is a very large domain. But if we were to talk about a specific domain, maybe say cell biology, or want to study that at a cellular level, then the students are encouraged to take up a project in applied biology domain. So let us say that if there is a challenge that is being faced by a certain region where we can study the principles of biology and then find a solution. So what we tend to do in such cases is in some places where the time is less, we club a few subjects together and bring out three or four subjects together and say, let us do one real life project connecting these three subjects together if there is a lack of time. In some places where we have a project based time, we say we will do an individual subject solution. Now, what we tell the student is that we will not give you the challenge, which I am very against. Like, therefore, I'm little against this whole concept of hackathons and those. They are good at one level, but because we give a challenge to the student, they are not owners of that topic. So they do it simply because they want to win a competition. It is not like, for example, I'll give you a small example. A young girl, 8th standard girl in one of the schools, she saw that her grandmother was not able to climb up the stairs with the walker because the walker does not allow a person to climb the stairs or come down. It can be a straight on a straight surface. So she saw this problem and was very startled. How do I solve this? And therefore, she took this problem to her science teacher in the school saying that, how can I solve this? So the teacher guided that look at different ways in which a person can go up the stairs. Don't look at walker, just look at a different way people can go up. So she did her own study on internet because she was motivated by the problem she had brought. And so she found different ways in which there are sometimes lift, sometimes there's a wheelchair being transported up. There are different ways. Then suddenly she came across, she went to a cycle mechanic one day and she was standing there. So she saw this concept of telescopic things, when one cylinder goes into another and telescopic approach. So she thought that, can I make the legs of the walker, the first two legs, which and the other two, which can actually shrink in, move in. So when a person takes the walker and puts in on a stair, the behind two remain same, the ahead two go in. And so the balance is maintained at a straight level. Then I pick it up and put it to next stair. Now this whole concept she brought out with the help of her school teacher and the local mechanic. And happy to share that she won the President Award. And now that whole concept is patented as an approach which is being used for a walker, which is an innovation by her. Now, why I'm sharing this is when the ownership of learning shifts from us to the student, as us teaching a subject to student wanting to learn a subject, that can happen if they find an interesting problem in biology and come back and say, I want to crack this problem. Then the approach that I shared with you, the sequential approach. And in this approach, we don't need, what we say is, while we apply design pedagogy, we are not subject expert. We are process expert. So we would be expert at how do people do a system study, observation, empathizing, articulating a problem. We are not biology experts. You are a biology expert. So what we do is that as this project pans out, the students are going through a structured approach to solve a problem that they have. And you come in as an expert. And that too, we don't come in as an expert when we want. We tell them, you are stuck, come back to me. So the whole ownership of learning is shifted there. This is the same approach that now institutions I shared, Stanford, Harvard, MITs, and the who and who of the world, even IIT Delhi is now approaching this, taking this approach to actually structure their subject learning in better. Now, whether it's a science subject, whether it's a commerce subject, whether it is architecture, whether it is engineering, that's irrespective. We are talking about an approach, a methodology that is used here. So I hope in the small time I've been able to address it to some level through some of the past case studies. But as I said, we can have a separate interaction and crack this and do a pilot experiment and see that what comes from the learning. And if it is done well, I can tell you that one thing that will happen is, as faculties, our 30% of the time will be saved. When the ownership shifts from teaching to learning and self-learning through these interesting projects, faculties definitely will have time to do more of their own research work, more academic interventions, which are progressive in nature and innovative in nature. This is exactly what is happening across the world in the academic domain. But as you said, each place has its own challenge, contextual to their institution, contextual to the kind of students who come in, to their aspiration, to the way the structure of the curriculum is being defined. So we will need to find therefore our own unique way to address it. But broadly, I think this is the way one can actually look at the same.
Thank you, sir. But I have one related question. First was how to motivate the students. And second is how can we motivate our administration, management, etc., to give the space, to give the time, and to give the, or the support system and the management system so that we can do this kind of studies. Because as you know, that we are regulated by the university mostly. It is not even the administration and management. Even if they want to help us, the university has given us a syllabus which we have to follow and so on.
Yeah.
So how can we motivate all these people or stakeholders to do these kind of studies?
You're correct. There are a few answers here. One answer is that there are very senior people like Subhash Bhatnagar sahab, because if you can understand the way IIM curriculum is structured, it is considered to be one of the most rigorous courses in Asia. The way IIM runs its management program, not giving a single space, a single minute of breathing space to students to relax. One of the most rigorous. How he brought in is because of his kind of confidence in what he is trying to do. He said, I will change the model from 2 credit to 1 credit. Now think about it. If suppose tomorrow I tell you that you are teaching a subject of 3 credit and you finish it in 1.5 credit time, there'll be a revolt here that no, that's not possible. But he experimented. He said, I will teach my subject in 1 credit instead of 2 credit. You bring in 1 credit for a project. So we have not changed the context. We have changed the way the curriculum will be delivered, the way teaching will and learning will happen, but it is still within the permissible norms of the university or government. If we even talk about government institutions. So this is one example where somebody says that I am ready to experiment and bring my, but first question is, can you teach your subject in lesser time and free up a time for a project work, one part. Second, suppose we are not able to do that, like I gave an example where we have worked with faculties who have actually created their own. So how we take this whole approach, it will make it clear. When we talk of mindset, the easiest way to bring mindset is to make the authorities in the organization a part of your project. Like I'll give you an example. It's easier said than done. We were approached by a prominent automobile giant, Hero Motocorp, and their top management said that we were partners with in previously by a foreign organization. So most of the designs used to come from there. We are just manufacturers, OEM. So we think that our middle level team is not innovative. We want to make our team innovative. So we created a whole program of 200 people and delivered. When I went to the session, these people said that, sir, you give us anything, we are innovative. But tell the management that to change the perspective. So we had to go back to the management and say there are brilliant people, innovative within there. How can we create a structure or a system for it in the organization? So when we created, we said, let us take this as a challenge, design challenge and solve it. So when we did this whole project of making an organization innovation centric or conducive to innovation, This whole project involved layers of different seniority present in the same on the same table to address the problem. So involving the stakeholders in the creation of the each or the whatever program you're trying to create, making them part of the stake, the whole workshop is one of the easiest. There's a very brilliant case on a good kitchen, which you can sometime look up on internet, where there were, this is still fine, but there are bigger challenges. Like when we work with airport authority, the first level of airport authority officials and the GM levels, member level, there is a big difference in their way they think about digital transformation and innovation. How can we bring them on the same table? So it took us a lot of effort simply to break the hierarchy and bring them on one table where there are different levels sitting together solving a problem. In fact, one of the biggest challenge was that the junior team members would not even speak because there is a GM level person sitting on their table. So they'll always look up to him. Then we had to break the ice and say that this is and there is no hierarchical structure here. It can, ideas can come from anyone. Views can come from anyone. It is a team structure. So there are ways in which this whole approach is being taken. So I tried to give you one as an individual example of Bhatnagar Saab and many faculties there. On the other hand, institutional way in which organizations are doing, like with GTU, think about it. No, there are 120 colleges. And the vice chancellor said, I want to launch four courses, semester 3, 4, 5, 6. There is no time. But he said Saturdays, 3 hours for Saturday. There was a whole revolt that happened. But since he had this vision and he was clear about it, we could implement it in across state. So there are institutional frameworks. There are engaging workshop-based frameworks. There are individual frameworks that can be taken up. However, as I'm answering, I can also understand that unless I know your perspective and the ground realities that you are going through on a day-to-day basis, it is wrong for me to comment in this manner. I'm giving you just models, but you can use design approach to take this as a problem and solve it. Like we, I said, no, faculty development programs, the faculties brought a similar kind of challenges. And they using stakeholder and design approach, they solved it over a period of time. So I would broadly say in this manner.
Thank you, sir.
Pleasure. By the way, what you have said is going to be one of the biggest challenges. Changing mindset is not a day's work, and that's the tough task. We are trying to see that at this national and state level, I think you must have seen the higher education policy. It's moving in that direction slowly, that we should give space to people to experiment and do things. I would say at that level, it will still take time, but at our individual level, we can start moving in that direction slowly.
Yeah, and I think your workshop being conducted in our college is one step towards that. So that is definitely like moving forward. But it is like we need to change a lot of mindsets to make this happen. It is not going to happen overnight, but we need to work towards it.
You're completely correct. You're completely correct, Ruchika ji. In fact, when I delivered this program at the CIO level, collector level, you should see how it has to be done, because they will not agree at all that there can be a mindset change brought at a rural level where there are hardly any resources we have. But the beauty of this whole approach, I would say, the design pedagogy, is that it is automatically, when you implement it, you will see that it includes these perspectives, which are, we call them wicked problems, problems that slip out of our hand the moment we try to solve. So design thinking actually works where the unknowns are very high in wicked problem situation. So I would say what you are saying is actually a wicked problem. A mindset and a temperament change is one of the most difficult things to do. but it can be done in a structured approach. As I said, it can be done top down or it can be done bottom up, depending on which approach our institution wishes to take based on our resources.
Thank you, sir. Gurshik, do you have a question?
Yes, Ramandeep, actually most of it was discussed what Ruchira was asking, but just a slight bit of an addition to that. So if I may, and if there is time.
Please.
Okay, thank you and a very good afternoon to everyone. This has really been quite an inspiring lecture. So I think that way we all are, you know, most of us here, like Ruchira was talking about changing mindsets. I think those of who are participating, we already, you know, are ready with that. My query is something, you know, related to that. So innovation is a great idea. And, you know, we go through the idea, the process of, which is a difficult process. And I'm presuming it will go through the process of conceptualization, planning, organization, execution, which itself is a task. Having said that, even if it's ready and if people are ready and if there is a mindset, what Ruchira was talking about, loaded syllabus. So I have a query. So does this innovation... Is the program, does it get integrated with the prescribed syllabus? Is it a separate from the syllabus? So that is something which needs to be looked into. I mean, if it is something which is separate from the syllabus, it becomes an add-on. And to some people, burden, to the people who are involved. I mean, it could be the faculty, it could be the students. But then again, doing it within the prescribed syllabus brings its challenges also. So I want to ask your take your response on that. Thank you.
Yeah, that's a good question there. However, I would say that it is both. We can, because at some places we are implementing it as an integral part. At some places it is given as an additional component. Like I'm sure you must have seen, some of the institutions have entrepreneurship cells, innovation cell. Now, what is the role of innovation cell? Sometimes it is taken that it is only for startup creation. I would take it the role of an innovation cell is basically producing innovation in academics in our institution. So the innovation could be in teaching learning practice, teaching learning aid, teaching learning environment, pedagogy, curriculum framework. It could be in any of that. So this is, according to me, an innovation cell's role is to bring innovation to institution. Startup is one of the activities it does. Like, for example, same for entrepreneurship. When we talk of entrepreneurship cell, it's not, its job is not to teach entrepreneurship or make people entrepreneurs. Can we develop a spirit of entrepreneurship among faculties also? So academic entrepreneurship. So this is one side. The other side is that if you see the policy that is getting framed, it is giving a chance to people to experiment in their own manner. Within the prescribed curriculum, if the outcomes remain similar or better, so that we can share that as a best practice or a case study as our finding. Now, suppose we do this experiment and we come up with our findings and we share it with the authorities, the university council, or and as an experiment we did. If it succeeds, it's wonderful. If it is partially successful, one can say that these are the learnings out of the same, and those papers that get published for the same give direction to other institutions of how they can approach and look at it. Now, that kind of a flexibility is always being available from institutional perspective, because the whole approach is saying that we need to bring in experimentation and best practices that each one should be documented and shared. So I would say that it is at both the levels. It is, there is a possibility, if we approach this whole thing, then it can be as a subject intervention, which is for a specific objective, like we want our students to become better placement ready. Now it becomes as an additional subject, saying that, okay, can we connect them to industries through a real life project and get them those skills that are needed for the same. At the same level, it can be, we want certain startups to be created. So that is an objective. In fact, some of institutions are collaborating. Like, for example, if we collaborate with, I'll give you, I can't name, but there's a very prominent institution of national importance that collaborated with a dairy and agri-tech giant government institution, simply because they want their students to have solve the problem of agri-tech and dairy and bring those solutions. So if we are able to, and I'm sure many of us at individual level are doing this, but what I'm saying is at an institutional level, can all of the faculty members pool in their strengths and resources and create these kind of bouquet of things which can be leveraged as an institutional resource? All of us, I'm sure 100%, because all of us write papers, work with industry, solve a societal problem. All of us go through this, but can it be structured through an approach which is then institutionalized? So that is my answer. I know it would be a little high level only because as I said, unless I know, and even if I know your specific problem, it may not be right for me to comment and give a quick fix solution, unless, as I mentioned, that one goes through a process saying, let's map all stakeholders, get everyone's views, opinions, perspective, looking at problem from a student and their parent perspective also. If they bring their views, like biggest challenge in management is none of them want a startup because they have paid so much money for their education that they have to pay loans. So how do we encourage startup on campus? So there have to be contextual models that can actually come out with the same. So I would rest on that in this manner. Hope I've addressed it a little bit, but it could be a separate discussion on the same. It's a vast topic in that manner.
Right. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir, for such an informative and insightful talk. Through case studies, you have aptly explained that now higher educational institutions, they need to reinvent the way they were doing the things. They need to adopt a pedagogy of design thinking. And there is a need to connect and collaborate with the local industry too, to provide an opportunity to the students to use their infrastructure. So thank you so much, sir. And now I would request Dr. Taranjit Rao, president of innovation cell of our college, to present vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Yes, thank you, Raman. Very warm greetings to all of you. In today's VUCA world, comprising of volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity, we need to counter volatility, vision, and values. We need to meet uncertainty with understanding, react to complexity with clarity and collaborations, and fight ambiguity with agility. Keeping this concern in mind, today's expert session on design-driven innovation was conceptualized. On behalf of my team, I take this proud privilege to extend formal vote of thanks. My profound thanks and gratitude are due to the distinguished speaker of the day, Mr. Rohit Savroop, Chairman, Innovation and Research Foundation, Ahmedabad. Sir, I truly appreciate your willingness to share your knowledge and talent on today's topic. Sir, I am confident that our faculty has gained a lot from your deliberations, and the knowledge shared by you has equipped us to be more creative and innovative. I assure you that our institution will nurture, encourage, and create a culture that is conducive to radical innovation and radical results. We look forward for more such collaborations with you, sir, in future also. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thanks. And greatly appreciate everyone's presence. If any one of you wishes to has any questions or views, you can connect with me on LinkedIn or through institutional, through Shilpi. We can also discuss. If there is anything personally I can do in helping, I think one of the key ways in which we can become a global superpower is nothing but education. both at a school and higher education level. And if we have to achieve that, each faculty member will have to contribute their own bit and part. And therefore, I feel happy for the enthusiasm that all of you had and the time you spared in the busy schedule that all of us have as academicians. So greatly thankful for that. And please feel free to write to me on LinkedIn or through institution. Thanks a lot.
Surely, sir, we'll get in touch with you. Now, I am also incredibly grateful to Ms. Shilpi Ghosh, who was instrumental in collaborating with us on behalf of Innovation and Research Foundation. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you, ma'am.
My sincere thanks are due to our worthy management and honorable principal, Dr. Navjot Kaur, for the encouragement and extensive support provided by them. My heartfelt thanks are due to my entire team of Innovation Cell for their enthusiastic and unflinching support always. My special thanks to all my worthy colleagues for making this event successful with their gracious presence. I look forward for their cooperation to create a culture of innovation in our institution so that we are in a position to provide real solutions to the real problems. Let's apply prototype approach to idea generation and problem solving as desired by sir. Once again, I thank everyone present here. Over to you, Raman.
Thank you, ma'am Taranjit. Now I would request all the participants to turn on their cameras so that we can have a group photograph. All the participants, I request you to turn on your cameras. Meena ma'am, can you do the honors? You are done with it? Okay, thank you so much, Meena ma'am. Thanks to all the participants. Thanks to the eminent speaker. Thanks, ma'am Ghosh.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, principal, ma'am. Thank you, sir.
Thanks.
Thank you. Ramandeep, ma'am, I will share the presentation as well as recording with you.
Okay.
I will send the recording link in the